taking ownership, so we are leveling up now. What can you do now to protect things and to really make things better? And it starts at the code you produce. There's a few things you can do regarding that. The development systems, because usually we think, okay, the production environment should be hardened and it should be secure and patches should be installed on top of it. But then again, the environment where we do the actual coding, we don't protect. And that's silly, because the most sensitive data or the crown jewels for your company might be actually on your developer system. And why are you not installing those patches? At least, I guess most still do, but I've seen a lot of cases where the development environment is, well, like the Dutch cheese with a lot of holes in it. And yeah, that's a shame. Of course, your deployment mechanism needs to be protected. And that can be, for example, something with GitHub. And your production environment itself, of course, because there the real data is getting inserted and you want to have that closed. Now, hardening. What is hardening? Because usually in the field of development, we don't talk about hardening. It's a system administration concept. Hardening is actually, well, adding new defenses and putting two-factor authentication on your GitHub account is actually a form of hardening as well. Some existing defenses can be there already. You can, well, level them up as well. So everyone is using a password, but you can enforce, for example, the password strength. And that's something you can do in your applications usually as well. Instead of accepting just everything, say no, at least the length need to be a minimum of 8 characters. And maybe you want to make it even more strict and say, yeah, it needs to have capitals in it or other kind of characters. Hardening helps with the so-called attack surface. So you have, if you have a planet, you can attack from all areas. You want to say, okay, I want to protect some pieces where the main and the most important parts are stored, so that other areas, well, which are not really that interesting, that you can ignore those. Well, you can harden a lot. So your operating system, the software, in the configuration itself. You can apply access controls for your users. Well, you can reduce the amount of services you're running on your systems. And that also, again, applies to your development environment, but also your production. And maybe an interesting question in between. Who here does also some level of system administration? Okay, I think it will increase with the DevOps movement, so more and more people will get access to the systems. And it's an interesting one, because normally from a development point of view, you want just to have things working. So you just install new tools and you install a compiler and all kind of supporting utilities, but you don't want to have that compiler on your production environment. Yeah, it's nice for debugging, but you shouldn't do it there. So who has this compiler there? No one who wants to admit it? I've seen cases really with people saying, yeah, but it's nice because we have something in production and we cannot reproduce it in our development environment. So we install all those kind of utilities also there. At the same time, they are opening up their environment. For example, if someone can bring in some evil code, then they can usually call the binaries on the system and they can use a compiler. And from there, level up and say, okay, I make something malicious, compile the code on the system itself and execute it. So then you can run, well, binaries, which were never intended to be there. So, and it's the same with user accounts. Lately I had a customer of mine, he was deploying voice over IP, and he forgot to remove a test user. and someone from Colombia or someone far, far away, they found out that account, so they made international calls. And on a VoIP environment, that's in a very expensive trick. So fortunately, his upstream provider discovered it very quickly because they got errors in their login, and they blocked it. But if you, well, it happened within 30 minutes after he made the change. Within 30 minutes, they made the first outgoing calls, and it was a few hundred euros already. So if they didn't, if the upstream provider wouldn't have said anything, and then after a month, here's the bill, wow. Regarding software, well, don't install what you don't need. It sounds simple, but really, configure things. Don't open up things directly because, well, that's the easy way. Now really think, okay, what kind of network traffic do I need? And should I just have something listening like a database? Should I have it listening on all network interfaces? Or can I just say, no, localhost is fine because my application is also running on the same machine, to make sure that you close those kind of, well, gaps as well. Well, users, we already talked a little bit about password policies. Make sure that you define password policies and also check in your own company. Maybe there is already a formal password policy. Then make sure that they also apply on the technical level, because often security officers, they come up with nice ideas on what things should be. And then on the level of development or system administration, people don't even know about those policies. So if you really want to do good, at least with your security officer, have a look at what's available within your company, so that you don't have to, well, think about it yourself or even define it yourself. Regarding data streams, well, data is usually the most important part to protect, and we can store it on our, well, filer, storage filer, or it can be in transit on the network. And by combining, well, the right level of encryption, for example, via HTTPS, we can protect it in transit, so that your valuable password details are not going, well, straight to the NSA. And also, well, on the storage level, that let's say someone can pull in data or a backup file, for example, that they at least cannot read it. And it's backup is an interesting part because it's also storage and data at rest. And usually we protect our production data, but then the backup data, which is actually the same, well, we store that somewhere and everyone has access to it. Well, that's a risk as well. And then the traffic flows, I said, if you can run things on localhost, do it on localhost. And also have a look at, what does your application really need? And it's common to find that we just open up things because it's easy and we can download all kind of stuff. But it might be also being abused by malware and then, well, viruses, worms. So you want to be careful what you open up. And as said, these are very high-level things, but still there are some things hopefully in it that you say, ah, wait a sec. In our case, we have that opened up as well, and we might have to think about it if that's really a wise decision. I guess most developers do also with something with web development. That's correct. Okay. A very easy quick win is not in your application itself, but on the level below, to make a small change, for example, in your Apache configuration or Nginx or IIS, to add some headers to tell, okay, this piece of code should not be running in a frame, for example, or if you want that to run in a frame, that you can at least say, no, it can only be run in that frame on my website if it's also from the same domain. And this helps with with those ads seen on well, most of the big sites nowadays, where they put in some malware into the the ad provider. And actually that means that sites like nu.nl, that those get infected and end up with you as a normal visitor infecting you with malware. Those kind of easy changes can help to harden up your application without you having to do anything in the application itself. So it are some interesting quick wins. And this is another one, and it helps with data with which you just inserted, for example, in a contact form, that it cannot be abused directly after it's submitted. So if I enter something with a JavaScript into it, that it does not get executed in the page after it. So it's a very small, simple statement which you can put into your headers, but it helps directly protecting your end users. And this is another one saying the data which is shown and then visible for the browser, that it considers it as being HTML by default, and that you really have to specify it if it's something else, so that the browser knows, okay, even if there's a piece of malicious code, I'm just going to show it as HTML, so nothing happens, instead of actually executing it and infecting another machine. Well, as said, I want to show some practical things as well. And tooling is practical, and it helps. So this site, it's hard to read. It's securityheaders.io. Well, you just put in your address, and it's in gray, but it's my my blog. And it tells you what kind of headers you have inserted, and they are there as well. So you can do a quick check. So tomorrow at work, pick the site of your company, put it in, and if it's red, well, contact your security officer or the webmaster guy and say, well, I have some quick wins to share. A nice myth about hardening is, well, you just do it once and then you're ready and it's all fine. And this tool is very interesting. It says no maintenance required, just set it and forget it. Well, that attitude worked maybe 10 years ago, but there are no applications nowadays which you just, well, run on something and then it's safe. It's like building the safe car now and then saying, yeah, in 10 years it's still safe. No, there are hackers, there are smart people who will circumvent every single detail. So these kind of software pieces, well, don't believe into it. It's really a process. You improve in small and many steps. Well, as I said, it's an ongoing process. Someone heard about those two attacks? Poodle, Heartbleed, yeah. It affected everyone of us, so that's a simple thing. And still there are some companies running old implementations of, for example, OpenSSL. And it's a shame because every single web shop where you enter your data there, well, can be sniffed by maybe the NSA, maybe the Dutch government, or maybe someone in Russia. Yeah, you don't know. So